St. Bede the Venerable is one of the best examples of serene English spirituality. The word in peace. All his life, from earliest days, he was in the Pax Benedictina, that ancient, unhurried peace of the monastic centuries, which still beats time over the Christian world. Time which has time to be, pulsating at the pulse of the clock and of the bell, which is its interpreter. And for St. Benedict, that bell is the vox delecti, the voice of the beloved. It was written on one monastic bell in France. So much so that he requests that the first ring of the bell, that all else be set aside for the divine will expressed therein. And so without delay, sine mora, however, without precipitation, he says, one hastens calmly towards the place of encounter, the Domus Dei, where one sings in conspectu angelorum, in the presence of the angels. Indeed, we were taught that information, that the carved angels' wings that were on the choir stalls that we had were a reminder that that was what we were doing. The angels were there, fluttering around us, and we had gratuitous moments carved out of time so as to sanctify time. At that time, in France, they were still using the interim breviary outside, the secular priests, and it was called Prière du temps présent, prayer of the present time. And that is what the liturgical hours are, liturgia horarum, the liturgy of the hours, hours sanctified on behalf of the whole mystical body. And therefore it is a vicarious role. They are asked to do it well, for many are engaged in many things in the world, but they are in extraterritorial territory belonging to heaven, and therefore time also is consecrated completely to the greatest possible beauty given to praise. Nothing is spared. And nothing either should take precedence over it. It's called the work of God, Opus Dei, and nothing should be placed preponatur before it in the rule of St. Benedict. As God created angels in the seraphic choirs only for praise, no need for any justification for creating an angel of praise. God has his rights. And then the work sustains the praise, and also the encounter which is never broken. And St. Bede knew that. There was not a moment in his existence on earth that was not bathed in presence. All he did quietly and unhurriedly, for there was time. The old Irish saying still holds good. The good man who made time made plenty of it. And the old Irish mode of behaving actually reflects that. They have time still to meet each other. What is life if we haven't time for each other? And so he had time also to do what can only be done in serene mode. Collect facts, collect thoughts, and put them down well and in an orderly manner. And so, as well as being a great scripture scholar, and of course now a doctor of the church, he was also a great historian, and his pen has transmitted unto us centuries later, through the work of scribes, of course, the history of the English nation. 7 books, the ecclesiastical history of the English nation. And when I was still an evangelical Baptist, strangely enough, coming across a part of his work, I was flabbergasted. It was one story that he told, amongst many, of Drithelm, who was a good enough man, but died, and was given a guided tour on the other side. And he saw many things, very many things, too many things for the comfort of an evangelical Baptist. So many things that I had to look into it and try to disprove it. But one cannot disprove evidence. On the other side, he saw what shouldn't be there. He saw purgatory. He saw also the power of the Holy Mass to deliver souls and shorten that purgatory. Many things which should not be seen because it wasn't in Scripture. If only we were serene also before truth and time. The mode of engagement with a book is not the same as that of engagement with a talking screen. The choice is ours, even in this privileged time of pause in the system, to accept or reject the challenge of encounter with the one who speaks more easily to the mind that has a peaceful mode. For reception depends on a certain stillness, and stillness depends on a certain emptiness. Only the vacuum is completely empty to be filled. The hyped up brain refracts, deflects the power of deep truth. There are too many syllables making too many echoes in a saturated brain. So Bede knew the power of the word, unhurried and unperturbed. And when the bell would go, he would go, and also do well what actually he was there for in the first place. Praise God, well and calmly. One thing at a time, done well, not two or three altogether. St. Bernard of Clairvaux, a great abbot, who had many cares because of his gifts, and he was asked to do many things even by the church, would go from the cloister to the abbey church, and as he was taking holy water at the holy water stoop, he would say to his worries, "Restez ici, je vous reprendrai en sortant." Stay here, I'll take you up again upon coming out. And so he too was free. By the way, he was one time, I understand, shown something about the angels hovering over the brethren in choir. He saw how some were delighted and had much weight of merit to carry up as the prayer of the brethren rose in chant up to heaven. Others were not so happy, and others were very sad, for they had hardly a thing to carry up. Why? Not all the brethren were engaging with what they were singing. Some were absent, and only some were 100% involved with what their lips were pronouncing. And so it's not enough to be in a place. We were taught, actually, that the choral prayer is in itself, this was what we were told, not prayer, but an occasion in which prayer can take place. Just a little warning, as we started a monastic life, that we also had to do our part, lest we waste the precious time of the church. And do well all except the most important thing of all, and that for which the church had placed us there. One day, some years ago, the ribbon came out of my Latin breviary, and I thought about the ribbon that actually goes from page to page, from liturgical hour to liturgical hour, and, as it were, stamps the time that we travel. The same with the chant. These notes have come from the centuries. When used, the voice of the centuries is heard. And from day to day, the hours of prayer are sanctified, also at the altar. The Hieros is the centre, the sun, but the rays are also present, and they are the liturgical hours, spread throughout the night and the day. I wrote this on just the ribbon of the Latin breviary, aware of how important it was to sanctify and consecrate the hours of praise, and do well the most important thing of all. We are a mighty number when alone. And on this little ribbon, many pass between these pages that remain unknown, save unto some that sat at this great class before. I learn the song of ancient time, oft ticking, ere were cogs so finely gauged. I hear the patter of soft feet that climb from yesterday's abyss, ours thus raged. I hear, I say, upon the ribbon's length, the turn of days, the ways of many hearts that into these words moved. There, where no strength, but loving's faithful all, its print imparts. For pages turn, where ages turned before, upon a pattern left on Kronos' shore.